share not necessarily the products or the people with you, but just the solutions. And I just had somebody pop up and mention to me that one of the things that they're interested in is trying to get more information off their website. And my answer to that question was, how many testimonials do you have on your website? And guess what the answer was? No. This makes it a little difficult. So I'm just going to talk for a few minutes about testimonials. Whilst you may not be able to get your existing clients to wander up and down George Street with a big sandwich board on saying, we think that Melissa's dead cat shop is wonderful, and you may not get them to write things, and it may not be possible for them to ring all their immediate friends and family and say, you should go to Melissa's dead cat shop, it is possible to create some sort of momentum and growth just by the power of testimonials. You see, as I mentioned previously, if I were to just go to the bookstore and say, hello there, I believe you did their cats, he's going to say, yes, yes, we do, and they're very, very good. But if I get a testimonial from somebody that says, you should be going to this store because it's great, it's good also. The problem with testimonials is because, as I mentioned, we've desensitized to things, but also desensitized to testimonials as well. Many of you will see lots of people, maybe like movie stars and things, advocating certain types of products. And you'll think, oh yeah, the reason why she's wearing this lipstick or the reason why he's doing this with that particular type of car is because they've given him a car or they've given him something. So it's important that your testimonials have credibility. It's important the caliber of the people that they come from. One of the things that I see often with testimonials when they're used is you'll have maybe three or four testimonials and it will say, this product is really good, Mr. and Mrs. J.H. Hodmossen. You see, the first thing I do when I see Mr. and Mrs. J.H. Hodmossen, I say, well, that's his grandma, or that's his cousin, or that's his uncle. So to get a testimonial, to get an effective one, you need to make sure that the people actually give you their name, give you their contact details, and give you their business, so that it looks more credible because of the fact that we're desensitized all the time. If you have a testimonial that says, I went to Doug's dead cat shop and it was probably the best dead cat shop I've ever been to, signed by John Howard, Prime Minister of blah blah blah, it's a little bit more credible than just Mr. J.H. of Kirribilli. So the power of testimonials is also critical on websites, it's critical on your point of sale material, and it's even more effective when you understand that it's actually, just another interest, if you actually go and buy a book, if you buy a book from Dimmicks or Agus and Robinson, you've heard them to the airport very, very quickly, the first thing you can see on the front of the book is a couple of little things, just a couple of little testimonials that say, great book, great read, etc. And occasionally you might have something like Tom Clancy says, this guy is a superb writer. It's from a credible person. You've got an opportunity. And you see, bear in mind that most of you in here have probably got industry-specific products or services. So you're dealing with specific smaller parts or precise parts of an industry. It's not if you're generic, like you're trying to sell Coke to everybody. So your testimonials will be relevant to people within your industry if they are from people within your industry. So therefore, your existing clients. Often what happens when you try to get a testimonial is you'll call somebody or you'll speak to somebody that's a client you might have had for some time, and say, just as a matter of interest, can you just give me something we can put on our website, put on our products to say how happy you are with us? And they'll say, yes, 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 yes. And you sit away and it doesn't come. Because they're busy, so you sit and wait again and it doesn't come. The easiest way to do this for you, if you've got people that you know well, that you know are highly satisfied with your services, just call them and say, look, you can tell me over the phone. Just tell me your opinions over the phone. What I'll do is I'll send those to you, so I can send it to you so that you're happy with it, and you can edit it, change it. See, people in most days, because of the fact that we're so busy, are reactive. And yet, in the most cases, when our businesses are passive, our businesses tend to sit here waiting for people to come. So unless they respond to adverts or respond to something that we do, we're passive, and yet as people, we're usually reactive. So you can ring them up and say, look, how about if I just send you a quick email that says, this, which is what you told me on the phone, and then they'll send it back to you on a piece of headed note paper. Once you've got that, you put the whole thing, including the headed note paper on your website, you put the whole thing everywhere. Because people are more likely to believe the whole thing than just a piece or a section of it. Another thing that's probably relevant about testimonials is when you look at the back of the book, maybe looking at the movies, you're looking in the newspaper, and you'll see a thing saying, coming up this week, Ocean's 13, and you'll see Margaret Pomeranz has given me 4.5 stars, somebody else has given me 3.5 stars. Those are the things that are right in the face. Those are the triggers. Those are the things that will not necessarily force people to purchase, but they'll interest people to look further. So your testimonials need to be very, very quickly in people's face, because they're expecting you to say, we're wonderful and we're great. Another interesting thing is that we have testimonials in our offices. We have them all over, because some days when you're working there, you get up on a Monday and you feel pretty good, and you turn into work, and everything's carrying pretty great, and it gets to about 12 o'clock, and the shift owner just comes and hits you on the head. It just happens. Everything that you touch collapses. And it happens to people that we work with. You know, on occasion you get the odd thing, and something doesn't happen right in a place, and the mic has to go off, and the electric ceiling's been open, and then the rain, and so on. And it's just, some days it just happens. When you're surrounded by testimonials about your own business, and when your people that work with you are surrounded by testimonials about your own business, it makes a huge difference to them as well. Because when they've just had one of those particular days, and they turn around to the phone, and you've got a few testimonials here, there, and everywhere, your testimonials should be not only on your website, they should be in your place of business. When people arrive, and maybe in your reception area, or if you're, for the sake of argument, a motor mechanic, or a dentist, you know, they also help to deliver value, particularly if within those testimonials people said, well, thank you very much, Stuart, and I really enjoyed my relationship with the dead cat shop. It may have been a little bit more than I thought I was going to pay, but I certainly thought the difference was worth it. What you're getting then is you're getting testimonials delivering value, as well as the fact they deliver credibility for you. So that's just a little bit. It's a very important thing. And a lot of people to download the testimonials as well. Talking about downloads and how they're just thinking about things, I'm so quick. Do you like coffee? Do you like keep flying with coffee? Right. Another way you can actually help to generate some momentum within your business is the use of press and press releases. Press is a very, very good thing, provided you don't advertise. And the reason it's a good thing is because they are interested in what you do. So you can have good stories and bad stories. They prefer bad ones, we've got to be honest, they do prefer bad ones. So if you're having trouble getting new employees, I don't know if any of you might have seen Today, Tonight, Last Night. Anybody see that? With a guy walking up and down the street saying, I can't get any employees. Can you see that? Yeah? I mean, what a remarkable, you know, this guy managed to get himself 25 minutes on primetime TV rather than paying for what would it have been? God knows how much that would have cost him. And also delivering a brand that he got to speak about his business. Press releases. That's a specific way to write a press release. But it will help you deliver the value within your business. Here's an interesting thing that you could do with your business. You can, for instance, create a survey of who's the person from a cost analysis type of training, a cost analysis place sat there. So we can actually create a survey and ring as many people as you know, CEOs, CMOs, etc., etc., and say to them, are you aware that there are savings available to people within, you know, your types of business is anywhere between 15 to 25% if you had somebody come and do a cost analysis on your business. And you're going to get a result from that. And the result is highly likely to be that most of these people will say, no, I'm not. So what you would then do is you create a press release saying, most of Sydney's CFOs and CEOs are completely unaware of the savings that they have available within their business. Then something or other of, what's the name of the company? Sourcing Value says that in a recent survey going to a large percentage of Sydney CFOs and CEOs, they're completely unaware of what the savings can be in their business. That's going to be get printed, because they'll put a little bit of a spin on that that will imply that some CEOs and CFOs are maybe not as street smart as they're supposed to be. And you can deliver all that. That's going to generically create leads. Right. Now, what I'm going to do now is I'm going to talk to you about a few things that are probably more specific. So I'm going to talk to you about some real products and some real issues and how you can probably try and adapt these to your businesses. First of all, I'm going to do a smaller product and show how you can create massive leverage by just getting your client acquisition costs going. And then if you remember about half an hour into the previous bit, I actually said there's only three ways to grow a business. it's probably unlikely that you could get more customers, more from your customers, and reduce your fixed costs simultaneously. I'm going to show you a way you can do it, and that would create exponential difference in how you build the value you want dynamics will create. Some time ago, we actually had a client. What I'm drawing on here is four little pots. For those of you that can't see, I'm sorry, I'm way away. So basically, little pots. The client had a product that he sold to people with rheumatism and arthritis. So, whilst I'm aware that obviously there's a lot of younger people who have rheumatism and arthritis in our form or another, the bulk of people that will have rheumatism and arthritis will be, in general, probably over 55 or 60, and most likely to be possibly older than that. So there'll be a certain type of profile. We have to know where our fish are swimming and identify this. And most of you, as I'm just having a couple of chats before, will be able to understand and identify the profile of your clients. This is the first thing. You need to think like the fish. You need to know who they are, where they go, what they do, who they associate with. Who's the person I just had a little bit of a chat with about golf things, and I said, we'll prove a point. Did I prove a point? Yeah? Okay, I'll come back to that in a moment. Right. Talking about, it's a situation here where we've got a chap who's operating out of a relatively small business, and he's selling rheumatism and arthritis pills. Basically, he's got cortisone here, but a few other bits and pieces in it as well. It's got sort of some of the triggery stuff in it, you know, like iodine, and tonga, and all that, and all this sort of stuff. Right. And his client acquisition cost was $10, and he sold the product for $40. Right. It was actually for sale for $39.99 on his website. So, his acquisition cost is $10. What it means is that wherever he's getting his business from, his website was not all that effective as well, so a little bit of work doing there. But subsequently, by identifying the client acquisition cost, what we can do is we can look at how the opportunities exist. So when you're looking at the opportunities that exist for a client of this particular nature, the best thing to do is to try and find out who his consumers would be.